No sweeter name than the name of Jesus. No sweeter name have I ever known. No sweeter name than the name of Jesus. No sweeter name than the name of Jesus. No sweeter name have I ever known. No sweeter name than the name of Jesus. You are the light to my heart and my soul. You are the light to the darkness around me. You are the hope to the hopeless and broken. You are the only truth and the way. Truth and the way. No sweeter name than the name of Jesus. No sweeter name have I ever known. No sweeter name than the name of Jesus. No sweeter name than the name of Jesus. No sweeter name have I ever known. No sweeter name than the name of Jesus. You are the life to my heart and my soul. You are the light to the darkness around me. You are the hope to the hopeless and broken. You are the only truth and the way. You are the life to my heart and my soul. You are the light to the darkness around me. You are the hope to the hopeless and broken. You are the only truth and the way. Jesus, 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 Jesus.
Sunday. Oh, we could try that again. Come on, turn to the person next to you, say, Happy Labor Day.
Happy Labor Day.
So good to welcome you to St. Joe today. My name is Chris. I'm one of the associate pastors here. And on behalf of the entire staff, we welcome you to worship today. We are still those crazy individuals that believe that God can change your life. So whether you came here today and you're happy to be here because there's a baptism, or you just came here today because, yeah, it's kind of out of tradition, we believe that when you get in touch with Jesus Christ, it can change your life. So that should get an amen. So if you come here today with heaviness or discomfort of heart, or wish to speak with one of the pastors, feel free to fill out one of the Connect cards. You'll see the Connect cards. They are a, how would you describe that? You're like an envelope, not an envelope, a binder, a tablet, a legal pad. I should have practiced this, but at the end of each pew on the table, feel free to fill those out. Pass them around. This is a great time to meet your neighbor. So fill it out and pass the person next to you and say, neighbor, it's good to see you. But we're going to fill out those. If you have any special prayer requests, feel free to fill out one of the prayer request cards. You can have them in the back of the sanctuary today. You're in for a good service today. We are here celebrating a baptism. That should get an amen. Let's have a round of applause for that. A baptism, yes. As well as communion. So today we're going to sing some songs. We're going to pray some prayers. We are here celebrating our church. And again, our church is, if you don't know anything about St. John, let me tell you a little bit about this. Our church is committed to being faithful, fearless, and fruitful. And why do I bring that up? Because it kind of means that you just may have came here today because of the baptism, because of the communion, or maybe just because you were in town because of holiday weekend. But our church believes that you, too, ought to be faithful and fearless and fruitful. What that means is you may not think of yourself as someone that worthy, but God thinks you are. God knows that. God wants to be involved in your life because he has created you with unique gifts and talents to be used by God. So you may have just woken up today thinking, I'm just a nobody. But God says, you are my masterpiece. So that's you and amen. Welcome to worship service today. We're going to start with a few announcements.
Good morning. Welcome to worship. I'm Erica, the office manager.
And I'm Glenn. I'm one of the pastors here. Welcome to worship. Boy, we have a faithful and fearless fall plan. And Erica, we've really gotten it underway, haven't we? Even at St. Joe UMC this week.
Yes.
Major cleanup happened in some of the hallways and classrooms. And so one thing that we want you to know is that some of those precious items that we weren't quite sure where they fit anymore as we cleaned out and prepared for the new things God's going to do are now located in the gym. You can get them this Sunday, or you can get them next Sunday, the Sunday after Labor Day. And if you'd like to make a donation for something you see there, have at it. There's books, there's some trees, some ficus trees, there's end tables, there's all kinds of little bric-a-brac in there to your heart's content, but there's things we're not really sure where they fit here as a team of trustees, lay people, and staff went through things this last week, so we hope you'll take a look. We must be fearless if we're cleaning out closets around here.
Oh, yes.
Yeah. But one other way we're going to prove that we're fearless and faithful in the weeks ahead are the postcards that we've had available for everyone. You know, we have 1,000 postcards. We've got, yeah, we do, with information about all three services on both campuses on one side, and on the other side, information about Level Up, which is starting next Wednesday night. Starting with all of our services, as well as we tilt into the month of September and a faithful, fearless fall, will be children's ministry and kids' church during all three services. Every service, 9, 10, 11, both campuses, ministry with kids happening during the service. You'll be hearing more about that next week. These cards, though, the real purpose is that you pray for and then fearlessly invite friends and neighbors. As you do, share your faith. Share what God is doing in your heart and in your church. It's going to be an incredible season. Now, we mentioned there's a lot going on around here. We want to talk about this coming week on Thursday and every Thursday in September, our Keystone Ministry. Those are seniors for the fort. They're going to be earning their ice cream every Thursday evening. Check your bulletin and check your e-news for details, but they'll meet at Praise Park at, I think, 6 p.m. and walk down to Zesto. That walk is how they earn their ice cream. Again, that's open for any senior who'd like to participate. And it's a great opportunity, again, if someone's not comfortable being invited to worship or ministry with children, just invite them for a walk to get ice cream. Let them get to know your friends, your church family there. Saturday, September 9th, from noon to 3, there's an event at Southside High School that's been hosted and planned by my friend, Reverend Melissa Fisher. It's been planned with support of other missional connections in our Northeast United Methodist Church district. The speaker for that event is Sarah Collins Rudolph. 60 years ago, she survived the bombing of the 16th Street Baptist Church at a time when we were told and led to believe that we lived in a land where all people could worship freely. She and her community found on one Sunday morning they could not. The scars in the African American community in that region and across the country remain, but Sarah Collins Rudolph comes to Fort Wayne so that we can engage in listening, in faithful and fearless dialogue that will hopefully be fruitful with one another. Again, that's Southside High School, September 9th, noon to 3. I hope that you'll make time for that important conversation and to listen to those powerful stories. And finally, one of the big events of September, and we don't want to miss this at all, is Waves of Change, led by our Women in Faith. They'll have a special speaker on Saturday, September 16th at 9:30 to 11:30 a.m. The speaker's name, Gloria Doty, talking about the work she's written and all the changes happening around us. How do we navigate that with faithfulness and in a way that's still fruitful in the world we live? If folks want to register, this is really why we're here, Erica.
It is. You can register here at the desk with me or online at our website, stjoemin.com/events.
And anytime in the future you're going to register and we say, show up at the Mission Center to sign up, that's right where we're at. We are standing in the new Mission Center. If you're with us at St. Joe at the Y, it's that same table in the back. That's the Mission Center on that campus. Welcome to worship. There's so much going on. You are going to have to pay attention to it. You're going to have to keep track of it. God is going to meet us there. I can hardly wait.
And now on this special holiday weekend, let's take a few minutes to meet and greet the folks next to you. We have some friends here, some family members here. So take a few minutes and say hello. And say hello to people you don't particularly know. So take a few minutes and say hello. All right.
Good morning.
Together this morning. Let's go ahead and stand. Let's go ahead and worship our Lord through song.
The ransom for my life, only you.
As we come to our time in prayer today, are there any things in particular we'd like to uplift in prayers or in praise?
Chris, I think it's a praise that Val is feeling well, and we prayed for her a couple weeks ago.
Yes,
and
yes.
The week before that, too, and
I
so
think
we're just
so.
Thankful for that.
Praise God. Yes, it's kind of scary surgery, and here you are, so praise God to that. That's that deserves a round of applause. I mean, that is a big thing. Come on, that's right. Praise, that's also, again, praises for the baptisms today, the communion today. It's going to be a good day. And again, sometimes I know it's scary to bring forth praises, and we don't want to tell everyone, but if you have something on your heart today, you don't have to let anyone know. Just kind of recognize. What I'm going to do is walk over here and just light a couple candles, because sometimes we come here with grief, right? We may not tell anyone, and we kind of act like everything's okay, but sometimes we do have a little bit of grief. Maybe grief from something that's going on in your life. And other times, maybe we have a little bit of hopelessness because life can get you down. And sometimes in our life, there are individuals who we've lost. Spouses and children and family and friends. And so, you know, it's kind of nerve-wracking to tell everyone this, but we won't just mention it. We just recognize that there's things in our life that are really tough. And so we come here today on this weekend, and we know that it's a festive weekend, and we might have cookouts and all that, but we also recognize that we come here today maybe with some heavy stuff. But hear the good news. God hears you when you cry. So let's enter into a time of intercession. We're just going to have a time of silence for each petition. So let's go to our Lord in prayer. God, we're sitting here in the sanctuary. And the reality is, you might have smiles on the outside, but inwardly we are carrying so much. The hardships of parenting, the struggles of work, the burdens of financial debt. Lord, we come here today and we pretend to be okay, but the reality is, Lord, we need you. So, Lord, for those who feel hopeless, hear our prayer. For those who are fearful, hear our prayer. For those who are hungry, Lord, provide sustenance. For situations where there is conflict, Lord, provide peace. For situations where there is death or illness, Lord, provide healing. And Lord, we come to you just acknowledging that at the end of the day, we need you. Lord, hear our prayers today. We thank you for all the blessings you've given us. Surgeries that have gone well. Friends and family that are here that are surrounding us on every loving side. We thank you for the gift of the cross and for that salvation, Lord, that comes into our lives. But Lord, we come to you today during this time of prayer because we need you. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Savior, I come, quiet my soul. Remember redemption till where your blood was spilled for my ransom. Everything I wanted, dear, I counted. Cross where your love poured out. Bring me to my knees, Lord, I lay me down. Rid me of my
Morning. I just wonder if all the kids that are here can pay real close attention, because I want to talk about something before we do something this morning. I want to talk about baptism for a minute and why we often practice the baptism of infants and children. Who here knows what it's like to have a flashlight shined on you? Yeah, nowadays we all can do it, right? Everybody's got one on their phone. And when the church baptizes a child, what it's kind of like is the church shining a light on them and saying, this child is loved by God. This child belongs to God. All the days of this child's life will be held in the hands of a loving God. That's our confession of faith, and that's what we believe. And so when we baptize a child, we do it in that way and in that spirit. And so with that in mind, brothers and sisters in Christ, through the sacrament of baptism, we're initiated into Christ's holy church. We're incorporated into God's mighty acts of salvation and given new birth through water and spirit. All this is God's gift offered to us without price. I would ask Stephanie and Marquis and Marcellus, would you come forward, please? That's fine. I'm going to have you guys stand right over here. And what we want is, Marquis and Marcellus know this, because we did a practice run before you all came in. We're going to have them stand right here. So on behalf of the whole church, I ask Mom and Dad here, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin? If so, say, I do. Do you accept the freedom and power God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? If so, say, I do. Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in his grace, and promise to serve him as your Lord in union with the church, which Christ has opened to people of all ages, nations, and races? If so, say, I do. Will you, Stephanie and Marquis, nurture Marcellus in Christ's holy church, that by your teaching and example he may be guided to accept God's grace for himself, to profess his faith openly, and to lead a Christian life. If so, say we will. Now you all as the church, I have a couple questions for you. Do you as Christ's body, the church, reaffirm both your rejection of sin and your commitment to Christ? If so, say we do.
We do.
Will you nurture one another in the Christian faith and include Marcellus, Logan, Lee, Brown? That's a lot of name for a little guy. In your care. And your response here is?
With God's help, we will proclaim good news and live according to the example of Christ. We will surround these Christians with the beginning of love and forgiveness, that they may grow in their trust in God and may become faithful in their service to others. We will pray for them, that they may be true disciples who walk in the way that leads to life.
Let's join together in professing the Christian faith that's contained in the scripture of Old and New Testament. Do you believe in God the Father?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ?
I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven, is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead.
Do you believe in the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church,
the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. Okay, Marcellus, remember what I said is that I would get a little water and I'd put it on your head, okay? Marcellus Brown, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and all God's people said,
amen.
Amen. Oh, come on now. All God's people said,
amen.
Amen. Amen. This job belongs to God. That's what we say. Praise the Lord. He doesn't look as thrilled as we are, but he'll get there. He'll get there. Well, let's give the family one more round of applause. We're thankful for that. And our key, the certificate is in there, along with some of the order of service stuff today. So there's a certificate of baptism there. We're thankful that Marcellus is baptized this morning.
Yeah.
You guys can head back to your seats. Pastor Chris, what comes next?
Here. It's okay, Grandpa.
Great.
All to Jesus I surrender, all to him I freely give. I will ever love and trust him, in his presence daily live. I surrender.
Thank you to the band this morning. Let's pray. God, we turn our hearts to you as we open your word, and we ask that you would move in our mind and in our hearts through the word that is proclaimed, through the water that is poured out, through the bread and the cup that is shared in the name of Jesus Christ. Oh, Holy Spirit, won't you visit us here in Jesus' name? Amen. Just let it die. Just let it die. There are some things in life that we come to. Some things that show up in our life and in our world, and we say, just let it die. There was a woman in Australia, age 64. Did anybody see this story reported recently? Age 64, she had a headache. And she was just feeling a little down, and she went to the doctor, and the doctor said, we see something on the scan, so let's go do surgery. And they took her in for brain surgery, and they found this brain worm. Yeah, that brain worm they found. And that's the kind of thing that when I see it, I say, just let it die. Why does that even live? They took it out of her brain. They took it down the street to an institute that studied all kinds of organisms and at a local university there in Australia. It was still alive. And of course, one guy looked at it and was able to identify, yes, I know what kind of worm that is. Normally, they live in the belly of a python. Yeah. He's horrified by that, too. Let it die, he says. Let it die. Yeah, normally they live in the belly of a python. And this lady had been out foraging in the Australian bush for some greens, just like some Hoosiers might say, well, I'll cook up some dandelion greens or something like that. She went and got some. But this snake that was infected with this worm evidently had slid across the top and left a trail behind it. She had not washed the greens adequately. That's the best theory on how this happened. So she had consumed some of the larva. I know this is a lot for a Sunday morning, isn't it?
Yeah.
And eventually had taken up residence in her brain. And my response to that is let it die. And you can probably think of things too. Mosquitoes. There's a whole long list of critters and creatures. And of course we can think of some hurts, some habits, some hang-ups. Some ways of doing thing in our world that we say, just let it die, let it go, get rid of it. Now, most of the time we cannot muster that sensibility when it comes to people we don't love, or even the people we love, we can't bring ourselves to that sentiment. And so it's not hard to understand that when Jesus confronts the disciples with the truth of his death, that their response is to resist it, to resist the impulse to let him die. That's actually what happens in the text of Matthew chapter 16. Y'all remember last week, if you were here last week, you remember, who remembers last week? Anybody here? I mean, you remember if you just went to the grocery store or what you ate for dinner last week, any day? Who remembers last week in general? We got about 20% this morning. That's good. So last week in the text, what you might recall is that Jesus has been talking with the disciples, and he says, who do people say that I am? And eventually he asked Peter and the disciples, who do you say that I am? And remember, Peter had said, thou art the Christ, the Holy One of Israel, the Son of the living God. And Jesus says, that's right, Peter, and on this rock I'm going to build my church. Y'all remember that story? Remember how that happened? Well, guess what? The verse immediately following Jesus' statement to Peter, Peter begins a very rapid fall from being the rock on which the church is built to being called nothing less than Satan by Jesus. And we actually see how it plays out. See, that whole encounter with Peter and Jesus and that confession had happened in chapter 16. And in verse 20, the next verse, Jesus says something that indicates things are about to take a dark turn. Matthew 16:20. Then he ordered the disciples not to tell anybody that he was the Christ. Why would he do that? Peter's just got it right. He just made that confession. You're the Christ, the Holy One of Israel. Verse 20. Then it said, hey, listen, don't tell anybody. Why? Because that kind of talk can get a guy killed. And it's not time yet. But verse 21, Jesus starts to tell him there's a day coming that you will tell people, and there's a day coming that they will kill. From that time, Jesus began to show his disciples that he had to go to Jerusalem and suffer many things from the elders, the chief priests, and the legal experts, and that he had to be killed and raised on the third day. Now, this to us is old news. This to us is a story we've heard many times. We don't even notice it. It doesn't shock us. But right from one verse to the next, we go from Jesus is the boss. He's the Son of the living God. He's the Messiah. He's the one that Israel's prophets have been promising. To in the next verse, don't tell anybody. And in the next verse, I'm going to die. They're going to kill me. How about that? Now, if we stop and really absorb that, it's kind of a pretty radical shift, isn't it? And so it's not hard to understand that this disciple Peter, one of the leading disciples, the one we relate to so well because he's brash like we are, and he's reckless like we are, and he says what he thinks. He's the most American disciple, perhaps. Peter won't stand for it. Peter resists it. Verse 22, Peter took a hold of Jesus. Can you imagine doing this? He takes a hold of Jesus, and he scolds him, and he begins to correct him. Jesus, you don't know what you're doing. God forbid, Lord, this won't happen to you. But Jesus turns back to Peter, and he says, get behind me, Satan. You're a stone that could make me stumble. You're not thinking God's thoughts, but human thoughts. Why did Peter resist? Is it because he loved Jesus? He didn't want to let him go? No, I don't want you to die, Lord. Is that really what it is? Let me give you a hot tip this morning. If you really love someone, won't you listen to them? Who here has ever been in a marriage? Okay. In that setting, when somebody comes along and says something uncomfortable, isn't the test of love that you actually try to listen, even if you think they're wrong? Even if you think they're all wet? So I would suggest to you that when Jesus says they're going to kill me and Peter says, no, Lord, no, it can't be, his response isn't out of his love for Christ. Because if it was, he'd sit down and say, look, you never steered me wrong, Jesus. Let me hear why you're going to say this is going to happen. But instead he says, no, it can't be. He tries to talk him out of it. Don't let it be so. So Peter, I would suggest to you, wants something else. And what do you think he wants? Let's just take a quick stroll through the Gospels to think about what might be on Peter's mind. Think about Matthew chapter 18. In just a couple chapters, Peter's going to get probably involved with other disciples in a tussle. See, at that time, the disciples came to Jesus and they said, who's going to be the greatest in the kingdom of heaven? Now, Peter's surely involved in that. What do you think he really wants? Glory? Power? Authority? No, Jesus, don't let him kill you. There goes the gravy train. I was going to help be in charge. No. Or what about other places? We see maybe perhaps where Peter wants. John's Gospel, chapter 18, tells us of the night Jesus is arrested. Then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it, and he struck the high priest's servant, cutting off his ear. The servant's name was Malchus. And Jesus told Peter, put that sword away. Aren't I supposed to drink of the cup my father gave me? What was Peter wanting that night? Was he wanting to listen to Jesus? Was he acting really out of love for Jesus? Or was he whipping out the sword to say, wait, no, we can't go that way. I've got something to protect here. Something to defend here. What was Peter really wanting? Of course, Jesus is arrested. All this that Jesus had proclaimed and predicted is coming true. After they arrested Jesus, you'll remember Luke 22 tells us about Jesus being put on trial. And you'll recall how Peter hangs out around the periphery during the trial that's going on, during the middle of the night. After they arrested Jesus, they led him away and they brought him to the high priest's house. And Peter, he followed from a distance. They lit a fire in the middle of the courtyard and they sat down. Peter sat among them, and the servant woman saw him in the firelight, and she stared at him and she said, this man was with him too. But Peter denied it. Woman, I don't know him. What did Peter want? Well, he wanted to save his own skin, wouldn't you? It went from, no, no, Lord, we were going to do something good. We were going to be building something great together, to, I don't want to die tonight. Now, let's name something here. None of what Peter desires is bad in and of itself, is it? To want to do something great, to want to be along with Jesus on a journey where you're doing good things, to change the world. This is all that Peter wanted early on. And then not to die, well, that's totally a good thing too, right? It keeps us going. To want to live is all good. So it's no wonder that when Jesus says, there's a time I'm going to have to die, that Peter resists it and says, no, Lord, don't let it die. I can't let it die. Here's the thing in our lives. There are things that we want and desire. And in almost every case, you and I could sit down and we could peel back the layers and we could find that at its core, almost everything we want, there's a good starting place for it. God puts desire in our hearts for a reason. But it can happen that what I want and what I long for, I want to fit in. I want to be seen. I want to be heard. I want to know I'm a part of the family. I want to know people care about me. That those things begin to move beyond their bounds, and suddenly, before I know it, my desire is bumping into Chris's, and we're hurting each other. Have you ever seen that happen? It can happen for us that these things that we want that are very good, oh, I just don't want to feel the pain anymore. That's a good desire. But it can happen that those things that we want and desire, as we stretch out trying to pull to ourselves that which we are hungry for and which we long for, it can happen that we run into the life of God. This is what happens to Peter. Now, I can't tell you why it is, but it is the truth that God's life is always about giving away. Think about it. When God creates all that is, God creates a space for creatures other than God's self to live, to move, to have their being. Light and darkness are called forth, water and land. All of this, God gives God's self away to create. And in the life and ministry of Jesus, again, we see it. It's all about God's giving of God's self away. God's life lived among us as creatures, all the way to a cross. So if we're reaching, hungry, I just want to fit in. I just want to be seen. I just want to know I'm loved. I just want to feel accepted. I just don't want to feel the pain anymore. It can happen that though those are good desires, we bump into each other. And we bump into the life of God, which is always a giving away, not a taking. We find ourselves challenged. Think about when you prayed for miracles. Most of the time, the miracle we pray for is to satisfy the deep desire of our heart. Have you ever had a miracle come to you? I've known plenty of folks who have. And when they do, most of the time what people find is that they are given the miracle. The act of grace, and on the other side of it, there's a cross. There's a demand that it be given away. It turns out it wasn't for them. If you've experienced that, you know what I'm talking about. If you haven't, consider it a warning. When the life of God bends down and touches our life, it's not only to satisfy what we want. It's so that we can step into God's life and start giving it away, so we can let it die, so that others can live, and so that we can live. This is something that is kind of scary, because just like Peter, we'd rather have a place, we'd rather fit, we'd rather have glory, we'd rather have all those things, but I'm telling you today, you don't have to be afraid to let it die. Beep. 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 We know the sound. It's the sound we hear when we're in a hospital room with someone we care about, with someone who may have driven us crazy, someone who perplexes us, but someone we love. Beep. 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 It's the sound that tells us that there is still a beat to their heart, that they are still alive, and it's a sound we hate. Because it's a sound that reminds us, listen up now, that there is a boundary to what we want that we can't reach past. We want them.
Beep, beep, beep.
But the sound continues as a reminder that there is a fence. There was a pastor, a colleague of mine, They had an older member of the church. All her family had been gone for years. Her only friends were in the church. And so when she came down to the end of her life, the church took turns, people took turns just sitting with her as the doctor said she's in her last days. The pastor eventually drew the straw to go in for one particular shift, and as he sat with her, she was no longer conscious. She had not been speaking for several days. He heard the rasp of her breathing, knowing she was getting closer, and he heard the beep, beep, beep. And so he sat. I've done this too. You probably have also. You sat, you listened. You heard the sounds of the boundary to what we want and what we desire. It is not wrong to want to live or to want those we love to live. It's not wrong to want a place, to not want to be seen, to want to be loved, to want to be comforted. It's not wrong to want to build something, to have the pain go away. None of that's wrong. But he sat and he listened to the sound we don't want to hear, that beep, beep, beep. He sat for a long time. Her breathing grew deeper, raspier, more perforated. And when he was getting prepared to leave his shift and turn over to the next person, all of a sudden, it happened. She sat up. She turned to him. She grabbed his arm. And she said, "Tell them it's real." And then, and she sat back, and she had traveled to the world that is to come. Now, I will share that with you today to know that when it comes to the things in our lives, our hurts, our habits, our hang-ups, those desires, which at their core there's nothing wrong with, but do get out of their bound and bump into other people or bump into the life of God, I share that with you today so that you might know that you need not fear the face of those things dying. I have known more than a handful of people who I've sat with in their last hours who could hear the songs of saints on higher ground. We need not fear death. But I've known dozens, okay, dozens, of people who are walking around living today who came to a point in their life where they had to let something inside them die, that some desire, that at its core was nothing wrong with it, but they had to be willing to take up a cross to let it go, to let go of that desire to fit, to be seen, to build something, that desire to have grace or be forgiven by someone who is never going to forgive them, the desire to forgive someone they could never forgive. All of these things, they bubble up in our lives, and I've known folks who have found it, the moment and the grace where they could let it die, and the good news is that we can let it die. And that on the other side of the cross, there's an empty tomb. But what we're all called to is a cross. So as Christians, we need not fear the simple invitation. Let it die. Let it die so that you can live. We take this in our hearts and we turn to the table and the meal Jesus gave us. And here's the thing this morning. I don't know what it is that you need to let die. I'm not you. Hey, here's the thing. There's a lot of days I don't know what I need to let die in my own heart. Can I get an amen? Amen. Sometimes I need somebody to tell me, "Hey, buddy, knock it off. Why'd you do that? What do you really want?" But we turn to the meal Jesus gave us, and we open our hearts to God, and we say, "Lord, we know there are things we're hungry for. There are things we've wanted, and it's hurt other people. And it has kept us from sharing in your life, God, the life which is all about giving away. So we carry those things in our heart to this meal. And we receive it as God's good news, as God's giving away to us, knowing we need not fear to let it die." Thanks to Chris.
let's be honest. Many of us have done things that we'd rather not have done. Let's be real. Many of us have said things we'd rather not have said. If we could be truthful, there are some times we think of ourselves too highly or regard others as too lowly. There are things in our hearts that need to die. But hear the good news. When we confess, just like the disciples did, when we set our minds on God, the reality is that we can be forgiven. We don't have to take that burden upon ourselves, but rather we confess with our lips and with our hearts, God forgives us. Jesus took up that cross for our salvation, and in return for our old life, he gives us new grace, new promises. And so we know today that if there's anything on our hearts that we've said or done or thought, just give it to God right now. And know that you can be forgiven. So in the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Thank you, Jesus. Now as we come to this table today, just remember that this table belongs to Christ. He ate with sinners, broke bread with friends, and it was at this table that he led and taught. This table does not belong to any denomination. It doesn't belong to any race. This table is at Christ's table. And it's here that we learn the good news of the promise of what's to come. So all are welcome here at this table who earnestly desire to further their relationship.
Steve, we're not going to use the liturgy that's on the screen, so you can just take that black until we go into the song afterwards. On the night in which Jesus gave himself up for us, he took the bread, and when he had given thanks for it, he broke it. And he said, "This is my body, broken for you. It's a giving away. Take and eat. As often as you do this, do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, when the meal was over, he took the cup and he held it high. And he said, "This is my blood poured out for the forgiveness of sin and for a new covenant. Take and drink of it, all of you, and as often as you do this in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these God's mighty acts, we turn our hearts to God in prayer. Let's pray. Oh God, pour out your spirit on these gifts of bread and wine and make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we might be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. Help us to see that on the other side of every miracle, of every confession of you, that we are invited into your life and it is a giving away, a surrendering, a letting of the old self die. Oh Lord, this is our prayer. You know what it is. You know what we need. Show us today that we might let it die. That we might let it die so that in Christ Jesus we might live and one day all together feast at his heavenly banquet forevermore, where there is light and life forevermore. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And amen. We want to invite you folks to come forward as you're able this morning. We've got a little different configuration for communion. We've got an individual cup. If you'd like that, I don't see the gluten-free up here. So if you prefer gluten-free, we'll still share the juice with you. And everyone has an individual cup, so that will still work for that. So at this point, let's invite you forward to receive the meal Jesus gave us.
A place where mercy reigns, never dies. There's a place
first dreams of grace flow deep and wide. All the love I've ever found comes like a flood flowing down. At the cross, at the cross, I surrender.
Preserve our bodies and souls to everlasting life. We take and we eat and we drink, and in our hearts, even when our hearts are hurting, we can be truly glad. Let's pray. Oh God, we turn our hearts to you, and we search them and we seek them. And we know that you are with us. We know that you're with us in everything we long for, in every good desire. And you are with us in gentleness when we come to the moments that you ask us for surrender and we don't feel up to it. So continue to shape us, continue to mold us, continue to, like you did for the disciple Peter so long ago, call us to share in your life a giving away, to share in your life which is a cross and a death, to share in your life which is resurrection, and which, if we follow your path, goes on forever. All this we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. As you leave here today after our final song, you can just toss these cups in a trash can nearest to you. You're welcome to do that. And now we have a closing song this morning to just center our hearts as we leave this place.
Please stand and join with us as we sing.
How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that He should give His only Son and make a wretch His treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns His face away as wounds for the chosen one bring many sons to glory.
Today, as church, we have gathered and we have been witnesses to the life of God, which exists in our lives, even in the face of death. From our first steps, like Marcellus, all the way through, God is with us. God goes with us, and God leads us, yes, to a cross. But God leads us in unending and eternal love to resurrection and to life that is fuller than we could have ever wanted. So won't you go in the peace and power and love of God today? In the name of Father and Son and Holy Spirit, and all God's people said,
amen.
Amen. Amen. You are dismissed.
How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond our measure, that He should give His only Son. His treasure. How great the pain of searing loss. The Father turns His face away as wounds which God has chosen for. Brings many sons to glory. Among us. resurrection. Why should